If you don't know history, then you don't know anything. You are a leaf that doesn't know it is part of a tree. This quote is from one of the greatest philosophers of ancient history, Michael Crichton. And I think it does a good job of explaining why we're about to take the two most boring school subjects, history and geology, and squish them together. With that, let's start where every great story starts, the Bible. Actually, people were writing about geology long before the Bible. In the 4th century BCE, Aristotle hypothesized that the Earth changed very slowly. Slowly enough that it couldn't be observed during a single lifetime. Aristotle's successor, Theophrastus, later wrote a book following Aristotle's theories called On Stones, in which he described, among other things, how various rocks and gems reacted when heated up. In the 1st century CE, Pliny the Elder wrote what might be considered the first encyclopedia set called Natural History. In books 36 and 37, he describes a number of minerals and gems, and even details a hardness test for telling fake gems from real ones, depending on whether they can be scratched with a steel file or not. People may have been studying rocks for much of recorded history, but for the history of modern geology, we need to start with the Bible. In the book of Genesis, the Bible describes a great flood which God uses to reset creation, ridding the world of evil men, and allowing a select few moral and just humans to repopulate the earth. By the 1600s, the prevailing theory was that proof of the great flood could be found in the earth's strata. Strata are the earth's distinct layers of rock or soil, like this one might be all granite, while this one might be sandstone. But the biblical story didn't fit with the theories of some. In 1666, Danish anatomist Nicholas Steno was dissecting a shark. He noticed that the shark's triangular teeth resembled things known as tongue stones, which were sometimes found embedded in rocky formations. People believed these stones to be the petrified tongues of dragons or snakes. And actually, our old friend Pliny the Elder, 16 centuries earlier, thought the stones fell from the sky during lunar eclipses. But Steno instead thought, if tongue stones look an awful lot like these shark teeth, maybe they are shark teeth. He believed that maybe, over time, the actual structure of the shark's teeth was replaced by minerals, keeping the teeth in the original triangular shape. But then, how are the teeth getting embedded into rocks? Steno wondered if perhaps dirt and minerals in bodies of water would settle to the bottom to form horizontal layers over time. New layers would form on top of old layers, trapping whatever remained underneath. To test his theory, he began studying cliffs in Italy, which led him to formulate three basic principles which geologists still use today. The first is the principle of superposition. This explains that if a sequence of rock has been undisturbed, the oldest layer will be on the bottom, and the youngest layer will be on top. Easy peasy. The second is the principle of original horizontality. This explains that all strata form horizontally. It's worth noting that we've since discovered minor exceptions, such as the way sand accumulates on sand dunes. Thanks to gravity, deposits generally don't form slopes greater than 45 degrees. We can use this principle to conclude that these layers of Bowfiddle Rock in Scotland were probably tilted by an earthquake or uplift or some other force. The third principle is the principle of original lateral continuity, or TAPULC for short. Yeah, you're right. No one calls it that. Anyway, the principle of original lateral continuity explains that strata form as unbroken, continuous layers of rock that will eventually thin out to nothing, or end at the edges of a basin if they happen to be filling one. Strata that are no longer connected must have been fractured by a force or separated by erosion, like you can clearly see at the Grand Canyon in Arizona. Using these three principles, we can understand the relationships between a rock layer's age and its position in the rock record. The study of that relationship is known as stratigraphy. Now, with Steno's contributions to our understanding of stratigraphy, he's sometimes thought of as the father of geology, or sometimes the father of paleontology for his revelations about fossils. However, most people consider the father of geology to be a Scottish farmer of the 18th century by the name of James Hutton. In 1788, Hutton visited Sicker Point, where he found nearly vertical layers of greywacke covered with horizontal layers of red sandstone. He reasoned that the only way something like this could have happened was over a huge length of time, allowing the gray rock to be tilted or eroded before the red rock settled on top. Hutton thought these layers in the ground came from materials furnished from the ruins of former continents, and that every day, the same processes that are eroding away large bodies of rock are also building up mountains. He called this process the Great Geological Cycle and hypothesized that it had been happening endlessly, forever. Unfortunately, Hutton's theory wasn't made popular until after his death, when Charles Lyell published the book Principles of Geology. His theory originally became known as uniformitarianism, an alternative to the Bible's theory of catastrophism, where the Earth was formed by catastrophes like the flood. It followed the notion that the same geological processes that are happening now probably happened the same way in the past. Thus, we can figure out what happened then by looking at things now. The name uniformitarianism eventually fell out of favor since, you know, almost nothing about the Earth is uniform. The term actualism was taken up instead, since geologic time can be explained through actual processes that actually happen. Actualism has had a huge impact on science, extending even beyond the reaches of geology. Charles Darwin himself used the concept of actualism to understand that, much like the Earth, life itself was also changing slowly over time. Without a developed understanding of geology, Darwin could not have written on the origin of species. Speaking of origins, I hope you'll join us next time as we explore the origin of, well, everything.